Good morning. As we end our 4 weeks of outdoor worship, it's fitting that we would begin our service and end these 4 weeks with Psalm 19. Psalm 19 reminds us that the beauty that we see all around us is the handiwork of the Lord. As we settle into our seats, the Lord invites you to settle your hearts and calls you into worship.
I invite you to stand for the call to worship. The call to worship in our worship service is a recognition that God calls us into this dialogue that we will have with him during worship. He speaks to us first. So listen and participate as he speaks to us in his word. The Lord, the earth is the Lord's and everything in it, the world and all who live in it. For he founded it upon the seas and established it upon the waters. Who may ascend the hill of the Lord, or who may stand in his holy place? He who has clean hands and a pure heart, who does not lift up his soul to an idol or swear by what is false. He will receive blessing from the Lord and vindication from God his Savior. The Lord be with you. Let us worship God.
Thank you.
Our Father, we thank you for this gift of praise. And Lord, we know that apart from you and your work within us, that we would tirelessly seek the praise of others. We would fruitlessly compare ourselves to others in hopes of praising ourselves. Oh Lord, the gift of turning our hearts and our hands upward and praising you is an act of your divine mercy. And Father, of all the gifts that you could give this congregation, we do pray that you would make us a people of praising you. We ask this in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and all God's people said, Amen. Christian, what do you believe? I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. If you have a Bible with you, you can open to Psalm 52. In order to understand Psalm 52, you really must know the context of it. Just a few moments, Reverend McHeard is going to walk us through 1 Samuel 22, which describes this context. But just as a summary, there are four people you must know. First is David. David was fleeing from Saul. And as he was fleeing from Saul, his resources began to run out. And he went to a priest, Ahimelech. This priest offered David food. When King Saul found out what Ahimelech had done, he was enraged. And as he was making plans as to how he would take out his retribution, there's one more character, it's Doeg. Doeg not only confirmed what Ahimelech had done, when none of Saul's men would take up arms against the priest within Ahimelech, Doeg struck them down, murdering 85 of them. So what we're going to read here in Psalm 52 is David's picking up a pen and writing out the emotions of his heart after this particular event. The first five verses are going to be him sorting out his feelings towards Doeg. And then there's this word, Selah. And then you'll hear the text transitions as David takes these emotions and begins to turn towards the Lord with them in the final three verses. Psalm 52. Why do you boast of evil, you mighty man? Why do you boast all day long, you who are a disgrace in the eyes of God? Your tongue plots destruction. It's like a sharpened razor who practices deceit. You love evil rather than good, falsehood rather than speaking the truth. You love every harmful word. Oh, you deceitful tongue. Surely God will bring you down to everlasting ruin. He will snatch you up in the tear from your tent. He will uproot you from the land of the living. Selah. The righteous will see and fear. They will laugh at him, saying, here now is the man who did not make God his stronghold, but trusted in his great wealth and grew strong by destroying others. But I am like an olive tree flourishing in the house of God. I trust in God's unfailing love forever and ever. I will praise you forever for what you have done. In your name I will hope, for your name is good. I will praise you in the presence of your saints. Amen. Now David did not have on his mind the New Testament sacrament of baptism when he penned this particular psalm. But what's true is that all the elements of why we need baptism are on full display in Psalm 52. I'm going to talk about just two words with you that are seen that help us to understand why we baptize children. And the first one was mentioned right after verse 5. It's the word Selah. We don't know exactly what this Hebrew word means, but it has to do with a pause. If you read through the first 5 verses of Psalm 52, David is in a fit of rage. A fit of rage after hearing about this murder that took place. He speaks of Doeg and he talks about this wicked man. The first verse, he says mighty man, he's mocking him. He's calling him a mighty might. He talks about this tongue that he has and the actions that he's taken. And then he threatens him. He says, God's going to take you and uproot you from where you are and send you off into the abyss. And then there's this word, Selah. And it's this moment as if David, after pouring out his emotions, pauses. And he takes a deep breath. You know, that's what the Psalms want us to do at times. It wants us to take a look at the world around us. The evil that comes to us from without. The evil that is found within us as well. And to take a deep breath and to realize the hopelessness of the world that we live in. Baptism, it's an outward expression of the inner reality of the hopelessness that we have apart from the Lord. Then the next word that transitions is that, where does David look to? And it says that he looks to this unfailing love of God. That's covenant love. That's the type of love that is seen from the Old Testament to New, that no matter the circumstances, God is saying that I will be with you. Today we're going to baptize John Mark, and Mark and Natalie, I want you to know that as great as parents as I'm sure you are, and as much as you're wanting to protect these two boys, your efforts are hopeless and helpless apart from the covenant promises of the Lord. We bring these boys to the Lord because we recognize that our only hope comes from Him. The water falls from the top towards Him as an expression of God's outward movement towards us. As you leave today, what I want you to remember is this one word of unfailing love that the Lord promises His children. And as you do so, may that encourage you in the days ahead. I'll ask you now to come forward with your family and ask Elder English to join. You these questions for baptism. Do you acknowledge your child's need for the cleansing blood of Jesus Christ and the renewing grace of the Holy Spirit? Do you? Do you claim God's covenant promises on His behalf, and do you look in faith to the Lord Jesus Christ for His salvation as you do for your own? Do you now unreservedly dedicate your son to God and promise in humble reliance upon divine grace that you will endeavor to set before Him a godly example, that you will pray with Him and for Him, that you will teach Him the doctrines of our faith, and that you will strive by all the means of God's appointment to bring Him up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord? Do you? And have you kept these covenant vows with your previous son that in good conscience you can take these vows today? Now to the congregation, not only do we have the gift of God's covenant promises, we have the gift of God's covenant family. Do you now unreservedly promise to pray for this family, to support them in both their physical and spiritual needs as they take on the admonition to raise this child in the Lord? Do you? I ask Billy English to pray for his parents.
Our Father, we thank you for this covenant being made this morning, this covenant that
Mark and Natalie are making with you for John Mark. Lord, we pray for his heart that you will bring him to yourself. We thank you for the promises that are his in Christ Jesus. And I pray, Father, that you would bring him to faith at an early age, that his testimony would be that he never knew a day that he didn't know about Christ. So pray for Mark and Natalie that they would raise their boys in the way they should go, Father, that they would not depart from you. So, Lord, we commit this family to you. We thank you for them. In Jesus' name, amen. What name is given this child?
John Mark Steely.
John Mark Steely. I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Shall we pray? Almighty God and loving Father, we thank you for John Mark. We thank you that you have placed him in your hands. You've placed him in this family who loves him and who would shepherd him. And we pray, oh God, that you would touch him and bless him, that your name would be on him, marked on him. And so to that end, we pray the Lord bless him and keep him, that the Lord would turn his face toward John Mark and be gracious to him, that the Lord would lift up his countenance upon John Mark and give him peace. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we pray. Amen.
Born into this world in need of the cleansing of Christ. We continue our journey in Christ in need of his cleansing touch. I invite you now to take a salah of your own, to think through this past week, this past hour, of ways in which you need to ask the Lord for forgiveness, and in doing so, believing that you'll be cleansed. Please join me as we confess our sins together. Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, maker of all things, judge of all men, we acknowledge and lament our many sins and defiant wickedness, which we from time to time most grievously have committed by thought, word, and deed against your divine majesty, provoking most justly your wrath and indignation against us. We do earnestly repent and are heartily sorry for these misdoings. Remembrance of them is grievous unto us. The burden of them is intolerable. Have mercy upon us. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father, for your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake. Forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may from now on serve and please you in newness of life, to the honor and glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. hear these words of pardoning grace. Here is a trustworthy saying that deserves full acceptance. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. Please stand in this assurance. Continue praising. Father, we do thank you that it is your staff and your rod that do continue to lead us. Thank you that as you lead us together as part of this covenant family. Father, as I look out this congregation, we're mindful of just how many young infant and toddlers of these covenant children that we have in our midst. And we do pray, O Lord, that the promises that they sing of in their classes and the promises that are being taught to them go into fertile soil, Lord, and that in the days and years to come, that they will indeed be transformed and live according to that which is true and real. Father, mindfulness graduation week, as many of our covenant high school seniors are making transition from living within the home and many of them moving beyond it. And Father, we know that with that movement, there will be newfound freedoms, and new ideas, and temptations and opportunities. So Lord, we do pray for them. that you would protect them, that in this early months of going to school, that they would find a family of God, that they would find a church, that they would find a community of people that encourage them in the ways of the Lord. Father, I pray for the parents. I pray that they remember that they're not just seeing their children move into a destiny of uncertainty, but one that is fixed and secure and known by you. Father, I know that in a congregation of this size, there are many parents with adult children who hear these promises of baptism and have a difficult time understanding them in relationship to where their son or daughter may be spiritually. And would they continue in their own hearts crying out to help their unbelief, to believe in the unfailing love of God, that even on this occasion they'd be encouraged by your promises to not only to them, but to their children as well. Father, mindful of those who are sick, some of who cannot be with us today. So do pray for Sissy Wheeler as she's recovering from back surgery. We thank you for the good progress that Nicole Novak has had. We thank you for her gift to us, not only on staff at the church, but her membership as well. And Father, do pray, continue to pray for Camille Albanese, who was in the hospital this week, and pray for Zach and Caroline as they continue to care for this little one as they're seeking a path of healing for her. Thank you, Lord, for the many, many gifts that you have given us, the gift of your covenant promises and a covenant family. We'd ask that we be a people of praise, thanking you for them day in and day out, and be a people of prayer, continue to pray, even as you taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. You may be seated. Just two quick announcements. If you don't receive our weekly Connect email on Thursday, there's an easy way to do that. That's the best way to know about what's going on in the life of the church. This upcoming weekend, there's two opportunities. One just across the river. Kirk Sowers and his band, the Woodrake Sessions, are having a concert over the North Augusta Amphitheater. You can reserve your tickets online for that. And also, Friday and Saturday, there's a Strengthening Your Family conference out at Redeemer Presbyterian Church that we're helping host as well. So take a look at those two opportunities. We would love to see you there. Just a moment, the ushers will be making their ways. You can provide your offering there. It's an act of worship. We thank you for your continued generosity to the church. With that in mind, may the peace of the Lord be with you always. Please stand and pass that peace to one another.
We invite you to continue to worship with us as we sing, This Is My Father's World.
My father's world, and to This is my Father's world.
We continue our series, Comparing Two Kings, on this morning. We're comparing David and Saul. During the last few weeks, we've looked at the ministries of these two kings and the conflict of two kingdoms. 1 Samuel chapter 16, verses 13 and 14, I think, gives us a theme for the entire book. Listen to what God says through the writer. Then Samuel took the horn of the oil and anointed David in the midst of his brothers. And the Spirit of the Lord rushed upon David from that day forward. And Samuel rose up and went to Ramah. Now the Spirit of the Lord departed from Saul, and a harmful spirit from the Lord tormented him. And there we see this picture of evil. We're going to see a picture of evil in 1 Samuel 22. And I have to tell you, it's a disturbing picture. It's a difficult picture to see because evil is rebellion against God. And evil can be defined as a brokenness, a fracturing of being whole, and a spoiling that turns something that is valuable into something that is not. And so we see here a king who was anointed by God, and through his disobedience, the Spirit of the Lord departed from him. And now we see the progression of that, what that looks like. In 1 Samuel chapter 22, there's a contrast of faithfulness and unfaithfulness. The first five verses, you see David and his response to the opportunities that God gives him. And you see in David a faithfulness regardless of the circumstances of life. But you see in Saul something that's surprising, because when we open the scriptures and we read the opening scene, you're going to notice something about Saul that shouldn't be a part of a king's life. And I have to tell you, it's part of the king's life because the Spirit of the Lord left Saul, and an evil spirit from the presence of the Lord tormented Saul. Now, I have to pause before we read scripture and just share with you a difference between our Old Testament saints and us. The Spirit of the Lord would go upon men and women and empower them to work faithfully, and then He would leave them in episodes. And that's why David said in Psalm 51, "Take not your Holy Spirit from me." We know that the Bible teaches us that the Spirit lives within us, and the Spirit of God will never leave us. So those of us who have trusted in the cleansing work of Jesus Christ, we'll never have to worry that we're going to be in the same condition as Saul. But there is a warning. The warning is this: even believers can act like, we can employ the tools of evil. And it can look like for a time that we are controlled by the evil one. Our Father will discipline us, but for a time, we can do the things that we'll see in Saul. So Let me give this warning. Even as I read the text and even as I try to explain what God's word says, know that this is an accurate history lesson of the past, but it's also a warning for us today that if we see any of these characteristics in the way that we relate to one another, that we recognize it for what it is. It is evil, and it does not belong in the household of faith. And so we may not always know what we should do, but we can certainly know what we shouldn't do. I invite you to turn now to 1 Samuel chapter 22. I'm going to read from the English Standard Version, 1 Samuel chapter 22. Please follow along as I read, starting from verse 6 to the end of the chapter. This is God's holy word, trusted, entrusted to us. Listen to what God says through his word. Now Saul heard that David was discovered, and the men who were with him. Saul was sitting at Gibeah under the tamarisk tree on the height with his spear in his hand, and all of his servants were standing about him. And Saul said to his servants who stood about him, "Hear now, people of Benjamin, will the son of Jesse give every one of you fields and vineyards? Will he make you all commanders of thousands and commanders of hundreds, that all of you have conspired against me? No one discloses to me when my son makes a covenant with the son of Jesse. None of you is sorry for me or discloses to me that my son has stirred up my servants against me to lie in wait as at this day." Then answered Doeg the Edomite, who stood by the servants of Saul, "I saw the son of Jesse coming to Nob to Ahimelech, the son of Ahitub, and he inquired of the Lord for him and gave him provisions and gave him the sword of Goliath the Philistine. Then the king sent to summon Ahimelech, the priest, the son of Ahitub, and all of his father's house, the priests who were at Nob, and all of them came to the king. And Saul said, 'Hear now, son of Ahitub.' And he answered, 'Here I am, my lord.' And Saul said to him, 'Why have you conspired against me, you and the son of Jesse, in that you had given him bread and a sword and have inquired of God for him so that he has risen against me to lie in wait as to this day?' Then Ahimelech answered the king, 'And who among all your servants is so faithful as David, who is the king's son-in-law and captain over your bodyguard and honored in your house? Is today the first time that I have inquired of God for him? No. Let not the king impute anything to his servant or to all the house of my father, for your servant has known nothing of all this, much or little.' And the king said, 'You shall surely die, Ahimelech, you and all your father's house.' And the king said to the guard who stood about him, 'Turn and kill the priests of the Lord, because their hand also is with David.' And they knew that he fled and did not disclose it to me. But the servants of the king would not put out their hand to strike the priests of the Lord. Then the king said to Doeg, 'You turn and strike the priests.' And Doeg the Edomite turned and struck down the priests, and he killed on that day 85 persons who wore the linen ephod. And Nob, the city of the priests, he put to the sword, both man and woman, child and infant, ox, donkey, and sheep, he put to the sword. But one of the sons of Ahimelech, the son of Ahitub, named Abiathar, escaped and fled after David. And Abiathar told David that Saul had killed the priests of the Lord. And David said to Abiathar, 'I knew on that day, when Doeg the Edomite was there, that he would surely tell Saul, I have occasioned the death of all the persons of your father's house.' Stay with me. Do not be afraid. For he who seeks my life seeks your life. With me, you shall be in safekeeping. Amen. To the reading of God's holy word, shall we pray? Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the opportunity we now have to think deeply about what it means to dwell in the presence of evil. I pray, Father, that you would allow us to recognize Saul's downfall and not employ any of those truths to the way that we live our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. There's a progression that's found in 1 Samuel chapter 22 that I don't want you to miss. There's a progression of sin and evil that leads to death. You know, the Apostle James talked about the gravity of sin. And he used words that talked about a progression that leads to death. And as we look at Saul's life, I want you to remember that sin and evil always has a determined direction. And that direction is death, destruction. It's a brokenness. It's a spoiling of what is good. But God's righteousness redeems and restores even what evil breaks. We're going to see in 1 Samuel chapter 22 that Saul sows discord, he spreads conspiracies, and he has serious disregard for life. Look with me again at verse 6. Now Saul heard that David was discovered, and the men who were with him. Saul was sitting at Gibeah under the tamarisk tree on the height with his spear in his hand, and all of his servants were standing about him. And Saul said to his servants who stood about him, "Hear now, people of Benjamin, will the son of Jesse give every one of you fields and vineyards? Will he make all of you commanders of thousands and commanders of hundreds?" Now, the tamarisk tree was a common tree in Saul's day. It was a tree that had leaves that would provide shade. Now, as I look out into the congregation, I feel a little guilty, but not much. Because I'm in shade, and every once in a while, there's a cool breeze that filters my way. And I see some in the sun, and the 11 o'clock service is going to be even more brutal than this will be. And the king is sitting in this shade and he's enjoying the cool of the day and he's holding a sword in his hand. That's strange, isn't it? Well, it's not really strange if they're at war. You want a king who is protecting you and providing for your welfare. That's appropriate for a king. But this is not a time of war against Israel. Saul declared war against David. And as we look at the text, you're going to notice some themes here. He uses the name of his son in a pejorative way. He's not my son in whom I delight. He's my son who chose to align himself with my enemy and he now is my enemy. Fellow Benjamites of the tribe of Israel, Saul is now calling them to stand up against another Israelite. He is sowing discord among the brothers. So the first tool that I would invite you to recognize as something that does not at all belong in the body of Christ is that which sows discord among the brothers. And I'm not just talking about the brothers here and sisters here in First Presbyterian Church. I'm talking about the brothers and sisters in Christ's Church Universal also. Those who may worship differently than we do, those who may hold different traditions than we do. When we sow discord against them, we are employing the tactics of evil in a way that does not honor the Lord. I am amazed when I look at what God said about evil when he talked about discord. He said there are six things the Lord hates. Yea, seventh is an abomination to him. I'm quoting the King James. Yea, seventh is an abomination to him. Those who sow discord against brothers. The other thing that's so remarkable to me, go back in your mind to 1 Samuel chapter 16, where David first enters the scene. When David first enters the scene, he's standing in the field, and Goliath is standing out, and he's yelling out these words against the people of God. And Israel, they're cowering in the background, and David stands out with his five little stones and his slingshot. And Goliath comes to him with sword and spear. You can read this in 1 Samuel 16. And David says, "You come to me with sword and spear, but I come to you in the name of the Lord." I find it amazing that God's anointed king is using the tools of evil to fight against the man whom God has chosen. This is now the fourth time, if you're keeping count, in Saul's life that he's holding a spear. Two times he tried to pin David against the wall. One time he tried to pin his son against the wall because his son made an alliance with David. This is an evil, evil, evil king. What do you do in the face of evil like that? David will give us the answer in Psalm 52. We'll get to that in a little bit. One commentator said this. He said, "Saul was no longer acting as God's representative. Matters of justice were being subordinated to the king's mad drive to eliminate David. Instead of doing what God had called him to do, he protected his own interests." Do you see the pattern there? Discord encourages us to protect our own interests. Saul, in his expression of evil, represented that. Psalm 133 gives us a picture of what God would desire among the people who were called by his name. Listen to what the Lord says. This is a song of ascents of David. "Behold how good and pleasant it is when brothers dwell in unity. It is like the precious oil on the head running down on the beard of Aaron, running down on the collar of his robes. It is like the dew of Hermon, which falls on the mountains of Zion, for there the Lord commanded the blessing, life forevermore." God desires that we dwell in a position of unity one with another, not with discord. The first sign of evil: sowing discord. Now notice with me the second sign. Look at verse 7. "And Saul said to his servants who stood about him, 'Hear now, people of Benjamin, will the son of Jesse give every one of you fields and vineyards?'" And he goes on and on. And what he's doing here is he's sowing conspiracies. David is against me, and he's against you. Now read 1 Samuel, and you will discover that David is not against the king. David is running for his life. David is trying to, he's seeking protection from the king. I don't know based on how we're assigned text, but there's a text in 1 Samuel where David has an opportunity to kill the king, but he doesn't. If I don't get to preach that, I'm going to refer to it over and over again because it's one of my favorite. David is not, he will not raise his hand against God's anointed. He's not against Saul. Why would Saul think that? I don't know. I think there are a couple of things in the text that may give us an understanding. Just the prior verses, verses 1 through 5, you read that David had men of 400 who gathered to him. And he shepherded them. He cared for them. And because of that, people in Gath saw that, and they called him king. They actually said, he's the king of Israel. And then they did something that drove the knife into Saul's back, as it were. They repeated that song that angered Saul. Saul has killed his thousands and David his tens of thousands. This is the king. Maybe Saul, knowing that, was angry at David. Maybe it was because Saul had just heard that David took Gideon's sword. And so now David is positioning himself against the king. I don't know what caused Saul to handle these conspiracies, but there's one thing I know about people who hold conspiracies, that it doesn't always take a whole lot of reasoning for people to hold on to conspiracies. And truth matters not to those who hold conspiracies. Did you see that? Did you see how Ahimelech was responding to the king, he says, why are you concerned about David? David is your son-in-law. David is faithful in your kingdom. And he recounted all the things that talked about David being a supporter of Israel, not an enemy of Israel. And yet Saul continued to hold on to his conspiracies. Conspiracies do not belong in the kingdom of God. They do not belong. Truth belongs. Truth belongs. So when we see in our communities of faith, either here in Augusta or in the CSRA or anywhere that we find ourselves among believers, and we see this conspiratorial attitude, we know that does not belong in the body of Christ. And there's one other thing that Saul shows us. He has a disregard for life, a disregard for life. I'm going to mention this quickly. As you read the rest of the chapter, Saul says to his servants, kill those priests, kill those priests. And listen to the description of how threatening those priests were. They wore a linen ephod. That's pretty threatening, isn't it? They were men of war, were they not? So the servants of Saul all recognize the fact, you do not lay a hand on these priests. That's going too far. That's going too far. But Doeg, the Edomite, said, I'll kill him. And he killed 85 of the priests. And don't miss what happened next. He killed the people in Nob. All of the people in Nob, the donkeys, the animals, that he left nothing alive. Remember, God had told Saul to do that. And Saul, in his disobedience to God, didn't do what God told him to do at that instance. But here now, he's saying, I don't care about their life because they are in league with my enemy. And I don't care about your life. Here's the third and final part of evil that does not belong in the body of Christ, a disregard for life in any form. When we see people as enemies, rather than the prince of the darkness of the air as our enemy. When we fight against flesh and blood rather than against principalities and powers, we step over the line. So, what's our response? Pastor Barrett read it to us, and I'm just going to summarize, refer to it David says three things. Trust in God's steadfast love. Trust in God's steadfast love. If you found yourself living in an environment where evil exists, instead of saying, oh God, why do you have me here? Trust in God's unfailing and steadfast love for you. And do not employ the tools of evil to get ahead. Remain faithful to God's covenant. If you're the only one that's doing it, remain faithful to God's covenant. Secondly, have gratitude for God's faithfulness. Look for the times where you have seen the hand of God stretched out and he's faithfully provided for your needs. And you don't have to look that hard. You even look in the life of David and you'll see that even during this very difficult time, God's hand was rested powerfully on David. It's not going to be long, even in this narrative. It's not going to be long until we see David fighting against the Philistines again and how God's hand was powerfully on David. It's because God's faithfulness cannot be stopped. Circumstances will never stop the faithfulness of God. Evil will never stop the faithfulness of God. Recount that. And then have a willingness to wait on God's timing and providential care. David said it a little differently in Psalm 37. And I close with these words. Fret not yourself because of evildoers. Don't even be envious of evildoers. For they will soon fade away like grass and wither like the green herb. Trust in the Lord and do good. Dwell in the land, even in the midst of wickedness, and befriend faithfulness. Look for faithfulness within our communities. Befriend that. Be drawn to that. Delight yourself in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. Commit your way to the Lord, and he will act. He will bring forth your righteousness as light and your justice as a noonday. Be still before the Lord and wait patiently for him. Fret not over the one who prospers in his way, over the man who carries out evil desires. Refrain from anger and forsake wrath. Don't get all worked up over that. Fret not yourself. It only leads to evil. Those are easy words to take from a person who knows what it's like to be hunted and harmed. And David knew what it was like to be hunted and harmed. And he's saying, learn from me. Don't be afraid of even the most powerful force of wickedness. Trust in the Lord and do good. Trust in the Lord and befriend faithfulness. Trust in the Lord in his steadfast love. Shall we pray? Almighty God and loving Father, give us the courage to be men and women who faithfully stand in the presence of evil. We recognize that our enemies are not other humans, because we wrestle against principalities and powers, against the rulers of darkness in our time. They are the spiritual hosts of wickedness. But even there, you do not leave us defenseless. Grant us the courage to depend on truth, righteousness, faith, prayer, and your gospel of peace. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. God speaks to us through his word. Let's respond to him by singing together, Praise My Soul, the King of Heaven. Now hear God's benediction. Now may the God of peace himself sanctify you completely, and may your whole spirit, soul, and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. The one who calls you is faithful, and he will do it. Amen and amen.